Seeing as how this is the program which previously brought you first television appearances from everything from the Beatles to the Buzzcocks, would you like to keep our hand in and keep you informed of the most interesting new sounds in the Northwest? This Joy Division is the most interesting new sound we've come across in the last 6 months. They're a Manchester band, with the exception of the guitarist, who comes from Salford. Very important difference. They're called Joy Division. This number is Shadow Play.
The genre of punk rock is responsible for spawning some of the biggest and most important musical genres of the past half a century. Many subgenres emerged throughout the latter part of the 20th century. Subgenres such as hardcore punk, pop punk, emo, horror punk, ska punk, skate punk, post-hardcore, folk punk, dance punk, psychobilly, crust punk, the list is endless. But it also led to the creation of many new full genres that took many parts of the body of punk and evolved them into something completely different. These include alternative rock, indie rock, new wave, noise rock, shoegazing, and of course the subject of this video, post-punk. Although much of the skeletal elements of the genre derived from punk rock, much of the genre takes sounds and styles from a wide array of different genres. The energy and DIY sensibilities of punk is still there, but musically the genre takes heavy influence from electronic music, dub, funk, free jazz and disco, just to name a few. In many ways, punk was a very straightforward and kind of basic genre. Because of this, many people looked down at it as almost pathetic and artistically cheap. Post-punk was the complete antithesis of this, taking lyrical influences from literature, modernist art and cinema, and blending genres together in a very avant-garde style. Similar to punk in many ways, post-punk can be considered an umbrella term covering a broad variety of styles and sounds. Due to this, the genre has been closely linked to the development of genres such as gothic rock, industrial music, and neo-psychedelia. In this episode of Anarchy in the World, we are going to take a look at the genre of post-punk from its inception through to its recent revival in the last 15 to 20 years. Punk had become a phenomenon in the media after the infamous Sex Pistols appearance with Bill Grundy. The controversy led to a widespread moral panic that caused the genre to be maligned. Following this, many bands inspired by the punk movement started to experiment heavily with lyrics and sounds to make them stand out significantly from their contemporaries. Many of these bands used a heavy amount of harsh sounds, loud drum patterns, and controlled white noise as described by John Savage in the Sounds magazine. Bands such as Throbbing Gristle, who even predated punk, had a clear post-punk slash industrial sound of their experimentation with tape machines and early electronic instruments. The 1977 debut from Wire, Pink Flag, is considered by many to be one of the first post-punk albums ever released. Despite coming out of the first wave of British punk rock, the album was unlike anything released at that time. Critics praised its lack of standard verse slash chorus structure, as well as the band's dissonant and minimalist arrangements. The album would be considered a landmark album in the development of post-punk, alternative rock, hardcore punk, and even Britpop. Songs from the album would go on to be covered by dozens of artists, including Minor Threat, Firehose, and R.E.M. Despite this album's influence on the genre, it was Susie and the Banshees who were the first band to really define the early post-punk sound with their spacious, disorienting, and angst-filled music. Their debut, The Scream, especially, is an incredibly innovative album, is considered a landmark in the genre due to its aggressive, visceral, yet very experimental sound. The dark, atmospheric sound of the band was described by many as gothic, leading to the creation of the gothic rock genre, but we'll get onto that in a bit. After the controversy of punk leading to its decline, many bands were forced to either change their sound completely or just flat out break up. One of the latter bands was punk pioneers, the Sex Pistols. Following the band's messy breakup, lead singer John Lydon strived to create an anti-rock band. Lydon approached his friend Jar Wobble to play bass and the Clash's guitarist Keith Levine to start a new band taking influence from broad musical genres such as reggae and world music. The band they created was Public Image Limited, a pioneering band in the development of post-punk. Their debut album First Issue received incredibly negative reviews upon release, but has since been considered a groundbreaking classic in the genre, which Pitchfork compared to future albums such as Daydream Nation by Sonic Youth. However, their second album, Metal Box, is the album that would define the band as one of the true pioneers of the genre. The album was praised for blending Lydon's punk roots with the dub sound of Can and the experimental electronic sounds shown on David Bowie's Berlin trilogy with Brian Eno. The album was packaged in a metal canister, which was incredibly weird and innovative for its time. The records were incredibly hard to get out and would be regularly scratched while taking them out of the case. Also, each side only contained 10 minutes of music, so listeners had to keep changing sides to listen to the full hour of the album. Another huge album in early post-punk is the 1979 debut from the pop group Y. The pop group were inspired by the energy of punk rock, but felt that the genre needed to evolve. Taking influence from avant-garde as well as black music styles such as free jazz and dub, they created an album described by Mike Watt as being funkadelic mixed with Captain Beefheart. Although reviews were incredibly divisive upon release, it since received unanimous praise and was even placed on the Wire's list of the 100 most important records ever made. Another band to take heavy influence from black music genres such as dub, funk and reggae are Gang of Four. The band's debut, Entertainment, would be one of the most influential albums of not just the genre of post-punk, but also just rock in general. The funky rhythms, shouted vocals and left-wing political lyrics would go on to inspire countless musicians including Kurt Cobain and Flea. Of course, there was a wide amount of post-punk bands to come out in the UK at this time. Bands like The Slits, Magazine, A Certain Ratio, The Fool, The Chameleons, Killing Joke, The Psychedelic Furs, Simple Minds, The Duh, and even Throbbing Gristle, all of which can be considered important post-punk bands, and all of them could have had their own little segments. However, I don't have enough time for that, so let's just talk about Joy Division. When it comes to post-punk pioneers, Joy Division is one of the bands at the very top of the list. The band originated after Bernard Sumner and Ian Hook attended a Sex Pistols show in Manchester. They soon put out an advert for a vocalist where they found Ian Curtis, and in 1977 brought in drummer Stephen Morris, creating the band's final lineup. Although Joy Division only made two records, the impact they had on alternative music is nothing short of astounding. Instead of focusing on anger and aggression like most punk and many post-punk bands did at this time, Joy Division emphasized mood and expression. They had a huge influence on contemporary artists such as U2 and The Cure, and would have a huge influence on modern bands such as Radiohead, Nine Inch Nails, Interpol, Bloc Party, Editors, and many, many more. The band's debut album, Unknown Pleasures, has received unanimous praise and is widely considered to be one of the greatest albums of all time. Many have praised its mysterious and moody sound and its use of effects and driving rhythms. Ian Curtis's voice has been compared to that of Jim Morrison, and his melodramatic crooning adds to the dark atmospheric sound of the album. Less than a year after its release, Curtis committed suicide. After his death, the band released the iconic single Love Will Tear Us Apart, which became the band's most recognizable song. They also shortly after released the band's second and final album, recorded a few weeks before Curtis's death. The album, similar to its predecessor, has been praised unanimously and is considered one of the defining albums in post-punk and early gothic rock. The remaining band members then regrouped and started the band New Order, a band who would go on to become one of the most critically acclaimed and influential bands of the 80s, expanding off the post-punk sound of Joy Division and going into new wave and synth-pop territories instead. Post-punk in America had quite a different origin story than it did in the UK, with it being created pretty much in tandem with US punk rock at clubs such as the CBGBs in Manhattan. New York-based band Television's debut album Marquee Moon is one of the landmark releases in American post-punk and punk rock in general due to its rock and jazz-inspired interplay and counter melodies. Guitarist Richard Lloyd and Tom Verlaine interplayed their guitar parts, with Verlaine establishing the rhythmic part guitars and Lloyd playing dissonant melodies over it. The album has been since praised as one of the best albums to come out of the American punk rock movement, going on to influence huge bands such as The Pixies, Sonic Youth, U2, REM, Joy Division, Echo and the Bunnymen, and The Strokes. And also to come from this scene was new wave and post-punk pioneers The Talking Heads. Talking Heads combined elements of punk, art rock, and funk together with art school sensibilities. The band's debut, 77, was praised due to their blending of art rock and mainstream pop melodies. David Byrne's strained, nervous vocals mixed with the staggered rhythms and self-conscious lyrics made the album an instant classic that would have a huge influence on future post-punk and art punk bands, but also on the development of new wave. Their collaboration with Brian Eno proved to be particularly successful as well, with their 1980 album Remain in Light being widely considered one of the greatest albums of all time. While working with Eno, the band started to experiment with African polyrhythms, stream of consciousness lyrics, and experimental tape effects and synthesizers. A prime example of this is their masterpiece of a song, Once in a Lifetime, which is led by a dub/reggae-inspired rhythm section and David Byrne's preacher-like lyrics. Also emerging in New York was the No Wave movement. The movement was created as a response to punk's recycling of old rock and roll cliches, experimenting with noise, dissonance, atonality, and taking heavy influence from free jazz. Many consider the compilation album No New York to be the definitive document of the movement, featuring pioneers James Chance and the Contortions, Teenage Jesus and the Jerks, Mars and DNA. By the 1980s, many post-punk/new wave bands started to adopt a more dance-oriented sound in favor of previous abrasive bands. Bands such as ESG, Liquid Liquid and the B-52 showed a mixture of hip-hop, disco, world and reggae sound and blended into the punk rock style. However, artists such as Swan, Sonic Youth and Glenn Branca took influence from more of the abrasive and noisy sound of the genre. Post-punk's influence is one that led to the creation of many genres and subgenres. Probably the biggest subgenre to emerge from post-punk, however, is gothic rock. The genre is known for using dark, atmospheric music mixed with more romantic lyrics. The phrase gothic rock had been used to describe post-punk bands such as Susie and the Banshees, Magazine, and Joy Division for a long, long time. And there's definitely no denying that they were a huge influence over the genre, and without them, it's unlikely the genre would exist at all. But many consider the first true goth rock song to be the 1979 song from Bauhaus, Bela Lugosi's Dead. The song is a 9.5-minute track filled with a dub-inspired guitar sound, atmospheric and haunting drums, and dark lyrics about famous actor Bela Lugosi. The lyrics show clear influence from many of the gothic horror movies from the 30s that Lugosi himself starred in, such as Dracula. Although originally written as a tongue-in-cheek song performed with a faux serious style, many truly believed the darkness to the track, and its success led to many bands starting to adopt more gothic characteristics into their music. With their fourth album Juju, Susie and the Banshees started to adopt these characteristics with mysterious songs such as Spellbound. Nick Cave's band The Birthday Party also released their single Release the Bats, a song that became incredibly influential in early 80s goth rock, even despite its self-parodical lyrics. As well as this, the punk rock pioneers The Damned released their 1980 album The Black Album, which was considered by many to be oozing in gothic influence. And of course, one of the biggest names in gothic rock and practically the poster child of the entire genre is undoubtedly The Cure. Although The Cure's early work was simple, raw post-punk, reminiscent of bands such as Gang of Four and Television, with their 1980 record 17 Seconds, they completely recreated their sound in favor of a very dissonant, atmospheric, and black goth rock sound. Inspired after touring with Susie and the Banshees, the album is full of dark, gloomy soundscapes which have been described as sounding like they were pulled directly from a Hammer horror movie. They carried these sounds on through their next two albums before descending into the more psychedelic new wave sound that the band would become huge with. However, in 1989, they returned to gothic rock with their album Disintegration, considered by many to be the band's magnum opus and one of, if not the greatest album ever to come from the goth rock genre. Gothic rock would also spawn its own punk fusion genre called death rock, a genre that mixed mixed the gothic tones with a more hard punk edge. The harbinger of the genre is widely considered to be Christian Death's 1982 debut, Only Theatre of Pain, an album so dark and satanic that it was reportedly destroyed on air on a religious TV show. Many of the characteristics of goth rock would end up influencing a wide array of artists who deal with the macabre, such as PJ Harvey, Marilyn Manson, and Nine Inch Nails. Although post-punk lost a lot of the experimentation and even popularity that it once had in the late 70s and early 80s, there were a lot of bands and musical genres that emerged taking heavy influence from it. One of the biggest movements to spawn from this was the new pop movement. New pop and new music bands made experimental music with a pop coating that was heavily emphasized by synthesizers and drum machines, androgynous looks, and lyrics about the darker sides of romance. Many of them blended elements of rockabilly, Motown, ska, and reggae with African style rhythms. In his book New Pop and Its Aftermath, Simon Reynolds said that it involved a conscious and brave attempt to bridge the separation between progressive pop and a mass slash chart pop, a divide which has existed since 1967 and is also broadly one between boys and girls, middle class and working class. Many new pop bands stepped away from the darker sound of post-punk and instead opted for a brighter and more accessible sound. The movement is in many ways less of a genre and more of a blanket term for alternative pop music in the 1980s. One of the biggest bands in this scene included the band The Smiths, whose blend of R&B, classic rock and roll, jangle pop, and post-punk would lead them to become one of the most influential and successful bands in 1980s British indie music. All four of the band's releases received critical acclaim due to Morrissey's crooning voice and sense of humor, as well as Johnny Marr's sophisticated guitar arpeggios and use of effects pedals. The Smiths have been considered by many to be the most influential British band since the Beatles, with a huge amount of bands and musicians citing them as an influence. These include the Stone Roses, Oasis, AFI, Blur, Swede, Modest Mouse, and The Killers. However, the biggest band to emerge from any form of post-punk background is Irish superstars U2. Although they would transform over the 80s into a pure rock band, their first few albums had a strong post-punk influence present. This is especially seen on their 1980 debut, Boy. Inspired by Television and Susie and the Banshees, U2 created an album full of huge and atmospheric riffs, along with lyrics about adolescence and growing up. The band's 1983 album, War, was their first huge success commercially, despite initially mixed reviews. The album was a lot darker than their previous releases, focusing on the physical aspects of warfare and the psychological damage that it can cause. It was the band's first UK number one album and even knocked Michael Jackson's Thriller off the top spot. It also appeared on Rolling Stones' 500 Greatest Albums of All Time list. The album's lead single, Sunday Bloody Sunday, is especially noted due to its harsh guitar lines and militaristic drum beats. It's considered by many to be one of the best protest songs ever written and the band's most rebellious anthem. In the mid to late 80s, the post-punk genre had kinda started to die off. Most of the post-punk bands had evolved into making new wave music, a subgenre that can probably fill an entire video, or they'd start making alternative rock. In the late 90s and the early 2000s, rock music in general started to become incredibly manufactured and rock radio had become filled with new metal, Britpop and pop punk, all of which was considered to lack musical authenticity. This led to a wide array of musical scenes popping up, creating the post-punk revival scene. The post-punk revival was a much more back-to-basics and stripped-down style of guitar rock, taking influence from post-punk, new wave, garage rock, and even blues. One of these early music scenes originated in Detroit and was led by the White Stripes. The White Stripes had a very lo-fi approach to their songwriting, which took a heavy garage rock and blues influence. The band adopted a very raw and simple style when it came to their composition, arrangement, and performances. The band would see wide success for their albums White Blood Cells and Elephant, considered by many to be two of the landmark albums in the revival scene. However, it was over in New York that the revival started to take shape massively. After huge success as a live band and after releasing a successful debut EP, The Strokes released their game-changing 2001 album, Is This It? An album that defined the entire revival and opened the floodgates to dozens, even hundreds of other bands who would emerge over the following years in both the post-punk revival scene and the indie rock scene. The album implemented the guitar interplay of Television and blended it with pop melodies and drum sounds that were crafted heavily to have an industrial sound. The album has a very urgent feel due to the band usually only recording the songs through once and using as little guitar effects as possible to create a live sound. Other bands to emerge from the scene in New York included The Walkmen, Yeah Yeah Yeahs, and TV on the Radio. However, one of the most successful and acclaimed bands to come from the scene would be Interpol. Interpol's 2002 debut record, Turn On The Bright Lights, received universal acclaim due to its heavy influence from darker and more atmospheric post-punk bands such as Joy Division, as well as the more raw and spacious sound of the shoegaze genre. Paul Banks' baritone vocals were heavily compared to Ian Curtis due to his gloomy moaning. The album was recorded and released shortly after 9/11, and the effects left in New York afterward can be felt all over the album. The album feels like it's portraying a very dark time in the world, and it feels like the band members are trying to put everything back together again. The album was considered a seminal release in the 2000s, inspiring bands such as The Killers, Editors, and The XX, leading to many people considering them to just be Interpol clones. Although the genre saw some success worldwide, it was really in the UK where it became a complete phenomenon. Bands such as The Vines, The Hives, Black Rebel Motorcycle Club, The Killers, The Libertines, The Cribs, Kings of Leon, Maximo Park, Block Party, The Fratellis, The Wombats, Kaiser Chiefs, and The Kooks were all among some of the most successful bands in the UK within the 2000s. However, the most prominent act in the post-punk revival in the UK would be Arctic Monkeys. Arctic Monkeys formed in Sheffield and started to make a name for themselves after demo CDs handed out in gigs were uploaded to the internet where they became viral. They were shortly after signed to Domino Records and released their 2006 debut, Whatever People Say I Am, That's What I'm Not. The album was a gigantic success and remains the fastest selling debut in UK history. It was even placed at number 19 on NME's 500 Greatest Albums of All Time. The album was praised due to its observational humour, fast, punchy instrumentation, and witty dissection of youth culture. They followed it up with Favourite Worst Nightmare, an album which also received widespread acclaim before they reinvented themselves multiple times over the succeeding albums. Arctic Monkeys' influence was seen instantly and can still be seen reverberating across the indie rock scene in the UK. They helped bring the post-punk revival slash indie scene to the mainstream. Suddenly, labels were throwing money at these smaller bands and trying to get them to be the next big thing. Bands such as The Cribs went from being small underground indie darlings to suddenly being thrown into the mainstream. Although the scene started to fade in popularity during the late 2000s, through bands such as The Vaccines and Catfish and the Bottlemen, it started to see a resurgence in the last few years.
All the words coming out of your mouth.
Guitar rock in 2018 is primarily dominated by indie rock bands, which do have a lot to owe to post-punk and especially its revival scene in the 2000s. However, there are a few post-punk bands around today that have either formed within the last few years or have been around since the original era of the genre. Bands such as Gang of Four, Wired, The Cure, and Nada are still going to this day and have released new albums in the last decade. Many of the big post-punk revival bands such as The Strokes, Block Party, Interpol, and Arctic Monkeys are also all still around and releasing new music. But there are also a lot of new post-punk bands in the world. For example, Algiers, who blend elements of post-punk, industrial, and gospel together to create some of the most unique music of the decade. Proto Marta, who blends the atmospheric styling to bands like Joy Division and Susie and the Banshees and blends them with raw garage rock and sensibilities. Savages, who blend a lot of the sounds of 70s post-punk bands with noise rock influences, and even post-hardcore band Enter Shikari went into post-punk territories on the last album, The Spark. And that's just a handful of bands making post-punk music in modern day. The genre has also had a huge influence over genres, many of which are among the most popular today. The genre is partly responsible for the creation of new wave, dance rock, industrial music, post-hardcore, synth pop, alternative rock, and even house music. It's proof that punk has some merit to it, that it's not just a bunch of untalented musicians slamming their instruments and wailing into a microphone. Post-punk is full of artists who strive to create art, which is one of the many reasons why its influence is still shown to this day. Although the genre isn't as popular as it once was, it's far from dead. Because all the time we have political unrest, all the time we have people writing perfect and overproduced music, there will be people striving for rawness and artistic integrity, and there will be anarchy in the world.